Oh dear, I didn't expect that. I don't know what this kind of video is going to look like. Hello, you lovely lot, welcome back. Hope you're having a fantastic day. In today's video, we're going to be talking about the concept of whether trauma and stress can cause brain damage. My answer to that, in layman's terms, is yes and no. So stay tuned if you want to have a little bit more of an understanding of why I think that and why the answer is so important. First of all, a disclaimer. I am not a doctor, I'm not medically trained. Everything I talk about in this video is my own perspective on the research that I have done on my own back. Please consult a doctor if you have any concerns at all about anything to do with your health. Okay, let's go. At the beginning, I just want to give a little tiny biology lesson, if you like, so that we understand a bit more about the parts of the brain that are affected. Okay, first of all, I want to talk a little bit more about the three areas of the brain that are affected by stress and trauma, primarily. And those are the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the prefrontal cortex. The amygdala is responsible for regulating our emotions, our autonomic responses, and determining what memories should and shouldn't be stored, and if they're stored, why they should be stored. The hippocampus is responsible for connecting memories to emotions, as well as spatial orientation, so our awareness of what's around us, and it's involved in those memories as well in a different way. The hippocampus sorts and stores the memories that the amygdala determines are worth storing, and it doesn't store them as an entire memory like a bubble. It stores it in fragments in different areas of the brain. And then we have the prefrontal cortex. That is responsible for future planning, personality development, and also our impulse control, so managing our emotional response to situations. And as I'm saying this, I hope you can understand that all three of these areas, they all link up, they all intertwine, and they all play a part in very similar functions, but they're different. And when we're stressed, we produce a hormone called cortisol. And cortisol is produced by the adrenal glands, which are just at the top of the kidneys. Cortisol itself is not a bad hormone. It has a purpose, it has a role to play, but it's when it gets out of balance, that's when you can find that there are problems. So when you're exposed to long-term, sustained cortisol, that's when it can affect the brain. An acquired brain injury is defined as a brain injury sustained after birth, resulting in a change to the brain's activity, which affects the physical integrity, the metabolic activity, and the functional ability of the cells in the brain. Okay, now with all of that out of the way, hopefully that's laid the foundations for just what I'm going to talk about next. And that is the effects of stress or trauma on the brain. So there are many things in life, whatever we're doing, whatever we're going through in life, it can cause us to become stressed. And that's not because we're weak, and it's not because we're ineffective at dealing with our stress. It's none of those things. It's just that because the world is the way it is, there's so many elements that can come into our life and stress us. It's very easy for us to get overwhelmed. We haven't developed coping strategies in line with the sheer number of stressors that we face in everyday modern life. So, as I mentioned, when cortisol is released in a chronic form, so long term, it has negative effects on the brain, and it literally shrinks the hippocampus and the prefrontal cortex. And brain cells will die off in that area, and that area of the brain will physically shrink in size and become less effective and function incorrectly. On the flip side of that, the amygdala will swell, will get bigger, and there'll be more blood flow to the amygdala. And so everything is now out of kilter, and it's not working correctly. So if you reflect back on how I said brain injury is defined as a change to the structure, a change to the physical functioning of the parts of the brain, it's logical to then say, yes, the brain is damaged by stress, by trauma. Structurally, functionally, the brain is damaged. And some stress is good for us. It's when stress becomes unmanageable and it starts having that negative effect on our bodies and we can't de-stress, we can't unwind from it. And that's when we begin to see the problems. So with the hippocampus and the prefrontal cortex shrunk down and nerve cells dying in those parts of the brain, the amygdala swelling, becoming over-dominant, there are certain things that can then manifest from those changes in the brain. So you have dysregulation of emotional response. So that's when your emotional response is out of kilter with whatever is going on in front of you. Difficulties with spatial awareness. So when you're stressed, you might become more clumsy. I know I do when I'm in pain, which causes me stress. I become very, very clumsy. It becomes more difficult to prejudge our situation spatially. So I'll give a really good example of that is, have you ever gone up the stairs or down the stairs and thought that you're one step further up or down than you actually are? And your body predicts how it should respond. If it thinks it's the last step, for example, it might cushion you as you land and push you back up, ready to go forwards. And if that's not the last step and there's another one, then you feel like you're going to fall. So that's a really good example of when that's out of alignment. Memory and cognitive problems are rife in people that are stressed. It's one of the first things that we notice. You have the hippocampus and the amygdala. Both aren't working correctly and both are crucial in the proper sorting, storing, and when they're not functioning correctly, memories is one of the first things to become affected. Cognitive problems, just the same. Forgetting how to tell the time, forgetting how to spell a word. It's really, really common when somebody's overloaded and stressed. No wonder that you're struggling to remember things. So yes, there is evidence to show that the brain structurally can be damaged and functions differently when we're under stress. However, due to the fact that we have neurogenesis, the ability to regrow brain cells, we have neuroplasticity, the ability to form new pathways, to act and think and behave differently, it's not a permanent damage. And there's so much joy and so much hope to be taken from that. And that's why I say yes and no. So yes, I do believe that it's brain damage, but no, it's not going to be a permanent kind of brain damage. The brain is an amazing organ, has the ability to change and adapt as we go through life. And that's the thing that I want to hold on to in this concept of, does trauma, does stress cause brain damage? I, for myself, as a piece of reflection, wanted to look into the concept of brain damage for people who have mental health problems, for people who are stressed, people who live with chronic stress. And finding out that, yes, actually, the brain is structurally changed and functions differently when you have chronic stress, when you have problems with managing your stress levels to the degree that the cortisol is having a negative impact on those areas of the brain that I've mentioned. It was quite a freeing feeling discovering that. And I didn't realize until I let go of it how much guilt I was holding on to, how much I blamed myself for not being strong enough to cope with the stresses of life, for not being able to deal with things better. And when you take it down to a cellular level, cortisol, that hormone is so powerful that it can kill off brain cells. It can shrink the size of parts of the brain. For me, it made it easier to understand why I might struggle. It made it easier for me to understand a little bit more about a functional neurological disorder, how the brain can function incorrectly. This was a video that was the most requested when I did a poll on Instagram. I think that a lot of people are looking for explanations that will help them be less harsh with themselves. And if that's the case, I really hope this video contributes to that. I actually feel quite emotional filming this right now, because I didn't realise until doing the research for this video how much guilt I was carrying around for what I thought was weakness, not trying hard enough, not applying myself to therapy hard enough, not being better, not doing better, failing. And it's been a journey, a good one, to find that actually my interpretation of the science out there explains why things have happened the way they have, explains why my frustrations. And if nothing else, making this video has helped me to be less harsh with myself, and I hope it helps you to be gentle and kind to yourself too. Clearly, it's not just a case of being stronger or trying harder. You know, when you're talking about cellular changes within the brain itself, then hold on to that. That's it for today. Thank you ever so much for joining me on this video. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you've got something out of it that's going to help you in your journey going forwards. If you have enjoyed it, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing if you'd like to see more of this kind of content from me. Take care now. Until next time, bye bye.